ladies and gentlemen, it's about tempo today. And I have given this lecture very many times, and it usually takes a couple of days. I have 45 minutes, so I'm in big trouble. Do not expect all the answers of all your questions today, but I will be happy if you leave this room with maybe a different idea and a different approach to the idea of tempo than when you came in. That's my only wish. You know, it's very difficult to speak about tempo in a specific period. It's very important that you start to understand how the tempo developed from the very first instrumental music to the moment of today. And I hope that I can give you an idea about this development. When you see, when you meet the conclusions of what you read in sources, and what you find out when you go into this difficult subject, many moments are very difficult because you are facing unbelievable outcomes and things you read. And that is, for some people, reason to stop the investigation concerning tempo, and for other people, other persons like me, a motivation to continue and to take the challenge and see if we can understand what we find. We have to take the outcomes serious, and we must be prepared to question our ideas and conventions. The first very important thing I would like to discuss with you is the fact that you can only speak about tempo when you also integrate all the other parameters of the performance practice. So tempo as such is a useless subject. It's very important that we see the relation with other parameters like affect, articulation. Well, you can mention all of them and they all relate to tempo. Because in my view, tempo is not the speed of the beat, but tempo is a culture. A few considerations concerning the fact that we think that people before, let me take the year 1821, did not or were not able to show the tempo in the school. You know, that the metronome was invented or was used as a metronome as we know it today from 1817, 1820, I think. And that is the time that we see that metronome numbers appear in the music. And many musicians think that before that period there was no information about tempo. Or they see some indications as indications for tempo, and they are not, but I come back to that later. This is a course on Baroque music, but I have to speak a little bit. You know, I think it's not really necessary, but I say it anyway, that my speech is a little bit provoking. I'm a bit black and white now, you know, to motivate you to maybe in future to work on this issue more than you did so far. And also because I think that some very important things did not really yet find enough attention in the music world. And one of them is this, the difference between Romantic music and Baroque music. I think we have to discuss that also. I said I am black and white a little bit. Music before 1800 is, in my view, played metronomically.
I mean, really patronymic.
After 1800, music becomes, the tempo becomes flexible. We call that tempo rubato. The first source on that, I mean the real, very clear source, is the Klavierschule of Carl Czerny, opus 500, which appears in 1839. And he speaks about that you can play a phrase in different ways. He says you can go slightly faster to the middle and then a little bit, you know, and a bit this and a bit that, but always moving around. And he says two very interesting things. The first thing is that he said the second most important thing of performance practice is the tempo rubato. But the most important thing of the performance practice is finding the right tempo. So in fact, the right tempo has a very important and strong relation to this free tempo. If there is no good, they call it in Germany Grundtempo, there is no possibility to be flexible. Right? Okay, in other words, when you play Baroque music and you play notes of this of a similar length, let's say you play eighth notes in a bar, they are not similar because they have their place in the hierarchy of the move of the time signature, right? In a 2-4 you would do yabba. So they are not similar. But they are metronomic. And they are not similar because you take value of the note, right? And you take it away, in fact. You take away sound of the note. When the note sounds longer, it's never longer than the time it has, really. When you play romantic music, you should never play similar notes in a similar way. The same thing, but in a different way. Because when you play romantic music, you add value to the notes. You can play eighth notes like this. They get different length. But it's no more metronomic.